Good evening, everyone. Welcome to our Good Friday service here at Grace Gospel Church. We are so glad that you can spend some of your evening with us here. And I'm just going to give a few instructions for us to let you know how the service is going to flow tonight. First and foremost, it's really our hope and our prayer that we would be able to have a time of reflection in here this evening. We want to truly recognize what it means to recognize Good Friday for what it is and what it represents and what it means. And so tonight, our service is going to consist of a few individuals who are going to share a reflection on the cross and the significance of Jesus' sacrifice for us. And then we're going to have a time of worship, even songs that offer a reflection on the cross as well, followed by a time of communion that we will get to share together. All right, and so everything is going to follow unannounced, and so you might have received one of these order of service for tonight. That's going to be your best friend as we walk through the service tonight. You'll notice that it says to please stand during the congregational songs, which are marked on your order of service sheet. All right, and so just please take note of that, and we're going to go ahead and get started. I'm going to go ahead and pray as we, again, enter into a night of reflection tonight for what Jesus has done for us. Dear Heavenly Father, we are so thankful to be able to gather here together this evening, and God, it is our prayer that we would be able to reflect on what you've done for us. God, it is our prayer that we would be able to reflect on the sacrifice of you sending your one and only Son, Jesus, to die a death on the cross. Lord, tonight we desire in this place to offer a reflection upon the cross and what it means for us. God, may we focus in on that tonight. May everything that is not of you, that is a distraction, God, may that just be taken away. God, may we focus on who you are and what you have done for us and the ultimate sacrifice that Jesus has paid for us. And it's in Jesus' holy and precious name that we pray. Amen. So what we want to do now is just prepare our hearts and our minds for what is going to be shared tonight for this time of reflection. And I want to do that by just spending time in the moments that led up to the events that transpired at the cross. See, following the events of the Last Supper, we find Jesus and his disciples in the Garden of Gethsemane with the cross very much looming large on the horizon at that point, and this is recorded in Matthew 26. It says this, it says, Jesus went with his disciples to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to them, sit here while I go over there and pray. So he took Peter and the two sons of Zebedee along with him, and he began to be sorrowful and troubled. Then he said to them, my soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch with me. Verse 39, it says, going a little farther, he fell with his face to the ground and prayed, my Father, if it is possible, may this cup be taken from me. Yet not as I will, but as you will. See, the cross that Jesus would soon arrive at was not only approaching soon in time, but it was very heavy on Jesus' mind in these moments, so much so that he was very much overwhelmed and troubled. He admitted so himself. His prayer again, twice more, my Father, if it is not possible for this cup to be taken away unless I drink it, may your will be done. That was Jesus' prayer in the garden. May your will be done. Jesus knew that God had sent him on a mission. And so tonight, we get to reflect on that. We get to reflect on this Good Friday. And it's a Good Friday because God, in his infinite wisdom and love, is allowing the greatest act, the sacrifice of Jesus, to come and be fulfilled. That's the greatest good that he could do for us. Make no mistake about it, Jesus knew why he came. Luke 19:10, Jesus said, for the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which was lost. Jesus knew his mission. He knew his assignment. Back to the garden now. After going away a third time in Matthew 26, it says, look, the hour has come, and the Son of Man is delivered into the hands of sinners. Rise, Let us go. Here comes my betrayer. See, the agony in the garden was now behind him. The brutality of his arrest, his beating at the hands of the soldiers, and the crown of thorns that he was to wear lied ahead. But even this was just the prelude to the cross itself. Jesus was arrested, taken before the high priest, and sentenced to death. Matthew 27, it says, after having Jesus scourged, he handed him over to be crucified. Then the soldiers of the governor took Jesus into the praetorium and gathered the whole Roman cohort around him. They stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him, and after twisting together a crown of thorns, they put it on his head and a reed in his right hand, and they knelt down before him and mocking him, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews!" They spat on him and took the reed and began to beat him on the head. After they had mocked him, they took the scarlet robe off him and put his own garments back on him and led him away to crucify him. See, Jesus, to this point, he was betrayed by those that were closest to him. He was mocked, belittled, and completely misunderstood by those that remained there. And those that remained are those that led him away to be crucified. And so, again, our hope tonight is that it would be a night of reflection. May we reflect in this place on what Jesus has done for us, the pain and the sorrow and the agony that he endured on our behalf, the road that led to Calvary, but be reminded of what Jesus experienced on this road to Calvary and what he endured as he was led to the cross to give of his own life. And so in just a moment, our worship team is going to lead us in a song called "Lead Me to the Cross." And this song reflects on Jesus' blood being poured out for us. And so I invite you now to reflect as an act of worship as we sing, "Lead Me to the Cross." Let me pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we are so thankful to be able to take a few moments here, gather together, and reflect on what you have done for us. Lord, the punishment that you endured, the mocking, the shame that you endured. Lord, even your closest followers left. And God, we reflect on the road that you endured, the road of suffering for us, God. May we not forget the reason as to why you came, the reason as to in the mission that you felt called to by God the Father. God, we reflect on what you have done for us tonight, and it is our prayer that even as we leave here tonight, that it would not be forgotten, that we would trust in you and you alone, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross. God, we love you. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Savior, I come, quiet my soul. Remember, redemption's hill, where your blood was spilled for my ransom. Everything I once held dear, I count it all as lost. Cross where your love poured out. Bring me to my knees, Lord, I lay me down. sin and death. Now you're risen. Everything I once held dear, I count it all as lost. Lead me to the cross where your love poured out. Bring me to my knees, Lord, I lay me down. Rid me of myself, I belong to you. Holy.
Good evening. I would like to share with you tonight reflections on the paradox of the cross. The cross is where the wrath of God and the love of God cannot be more clearly displayed for the world to see. The wrath of God is seen in what the cross is. And the love of God is seen in who hangs on the cross. What is the cross? The cross was a form of capital punishment that was invented by the Persians and perfected by the Romans. And it was designed to maximize the shame and the suffering of the condemned. The English word for excruciating is derived from the word crucifixion. And victims would be hanging on the cross for potentially days, and they were naked, and they would have animals feed on them, and insects burrow into their wounds. The cross reveals the wrath of God. And we know that God is holy and he's righteous and he exacts justice. And without justice, there is no holiness. There is no perfection. There needs to be a penalty for sin. It cannot be allowed. And we know that Jesus was the payment for sin. We know that his mission was to take that burden upon himself so we wouldn't have to. He started paying that sin in the Garden of Gethsemane, where Jesus, the man, experienced an anxiety that cannot be described. Have you ever experienced an anxiety when you became physically sick? The angst that Jesus felt was so intense that the capillaries that surround his sweat glands burst and blood oozed through his skin. And why did he experience this angst? And I don't have an exact answer for that, but maybe it's because he knew what was in front of him. He knew what that wrath was going to feel like. But maybe the most distressing thing for him was that for the first time in eternity past, he was going to be separated from his father. From the garden, he was led to an illegal trial, and he was eventually condemned for a crime he did not commit. He faced beatings and floggings that rendered him to be unrecognizable as a human being. That's what the Bible tells us. The Bible tells us that by his stripes, we were healed. The Greek word for stripes is actually a singular word. The word is malops. So it's really by his stripe we are healed. And some theorize that his back was so marred that it looked like one big oozing wound. He was mocked, and a helmet of 1-inch thorns was pushed into his scalp. And he was forced to carry a cross after almost a day without water and food. Surely he was dehydrated and weak and in agonizing pain. When he arrived at the place of the skull, he was nailed to the cross. And those nails pierced his hands or his wrists, and his ankles or his feet. And there are large nerves in the wrists and ankles that were surely pierced when those nails were driven through, sending shooting and shocking pain up and down his arms and legs. As the cross was raised into position, the weight of his body started to pull on those nails, and gravity started to compress and constrict his chest. And it became increasingly more difficult for him to breathe. Breathing in is an active process. You use muscles to breathe in. Breathing out is passive. It just happens naturally under normal circumstances. But when you're hanging on a cross and your body weight is on top of your lungs and your heart, you cannot breathe out. So imagine breathing in and only breathing in. And the only way to breathe out was to pull up on the cross. And imagine your wrists rotating around those nails, and imagine that scourged back rubbing up against the post of the cross. Excruciating pain with every breath. The weight of his body was so great that his heart would have difficulty pumping, and his lungs would fill with fluid. And ultimately, our Lord would succumb to suffocation. And it's demonstrated and proven by that final act of piercing his side and the release of all the fluid from his lungs, which just demonstrates that he passed from congestive heart failure. So let's take a pause here and think about this. If this is the wrath of God demonstrated to us for all to see, then what does that mean for the unrepentant sinner? If one were to die without Christ, is this a picture of what they face? Is that why the Bible says that there is weeping and gnashing of teeth? Is there an endless angst so great that one oozes blood through their skin? Is there a constant sense of shame and betrayal? Is there excruciating and agonizing physical pain and a gasping for air for eternity? It's unthinkable. We don't want to think about that. But this is the picture of the wrath of God that surely must come. And this is what we see on the cross, but we also see on the cross the who. Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God, the Savior of the world, the Messiah, paid the price, took that wrath of God in our place. The only begotten Son, the Lord of Lords, the King of Kings, demonstrating the love of God with these final words, "It is accomplished."
I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted, you were condemned. I'm alive and well, your spirit is within me because you died and rose again. Because you were forsaken, I'm accepted, you were condemned. I'm alive and well, your spirit is within me, because you died and rose again. You are my King. Jesus, you are my King. Jesus, you are my King.
Good evening. Tonight I'll be reflecting on the suffering of the cross. 1 Corinthians 1:18, for the word of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. The cross of Christianity is built with a vertical beam pointing to heaven and a horizontal beam following the earth's horizon. Placed together, these two beams bring heaven and earth together, a sign of hope beyond this life. Sin entered the world through the fall of Adam and Eve, but God, in his great love for mankind, promised a redeemer. Jesus fulfilled that promise and reconciled man with God. John 3:16 and 17, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send the Son into the world to judge the world, but that the world might be saved through him. It was God's plan, after the disobedience of Adam and Eve, to step down from his throne, become fully man, and take on our sins. On the cross, Jesus took all our sins upon him and was crucified. Isaiah 53:5. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him, and by his wounds we are healed. Acceptance of our own cross is what we are asked to do. Sometimes in our own lives, we are asked to take on suffering and pain, even when we don't understand. God desires for us to trust in his plan and his purpose. 1 Peter 5:10, after you have suffered for a little while, the God of all grace, who called you to his eternal glory in Christ, will himself perfect, confirm, strengthen, and establish you. The cross symbolizes God's incredible love for us. Speaking for myself, and perhaps most of you, we are incapable to fully grasp a love so deep. The cross symbolizes salvation, a surrendered life, and a new life with our Savior, Jesus Christ. The suffering of the cross is the ultimate inspiration for Christians to follow and to draw closer to God through his grace. Galatians 2:20, I have been crucified with Christ, and it is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself up for me. I asked some Christian family and friends, what does it mean to take up your cross? Here are their responses. Rosemary said, to me, pick up your cross speaks of counting the cost to follow Jesus, a full surrender to him alone. Sometimes those are very easy choices, and sometimes they are very hard. Janet said, picking up my own cross reminds me what Jesus did with his cross. He took my sin, my pain, my suffering, my sicknesses, everything. The choice is easy once you have tasted of the love and mercy of God. The only choice is to pick up that cross and do what Jesus says, follow me. Frank said, taking up my cross means to be in active surrender, to choose willingly and with knowledge of the struggle to come, to seek out and submit to God's authority and plan. Surrender in this way is not about being defeated, but instead it is us choosing to belong to God instead of the world. It is a constant struggle, and we are called to engage and withstand the burdens of that daily struggle until our Father calls us home.
To the cross I cling, of its suffering I do drink, of its work I do sing. For on it my Savior, both bruised and crushed, showed that God is cross. You beckon me, you draw me gently to my knees, and I am lost for words, so lost in love, and I am sweetly broken, wholly gently to my knees. so lost in love, and I'm sweetly broken. Holy surrender at the cross, you beckon me, you draw me gently to my knees, and I am lost for words, so lost in love, and I am sweetly broken. Holy surrender, I'm broken for you, I'm broken for you, I'm so broken for you.
Good evening. Oops. So I will reflect tonight on the sufficiency of the cross. Jim actually ended with what Jesus said in John 19:30 from the cross. We learn he said, "It is finished." His words there can be translated paid in full, as in the debt is now canceled. Ephesians 1:7 says, "We have our redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of trespasses according to the riches of his grace." In Jesus, our debt of sin is canceled. We are justified, redeemed, right with the holy God. It is finished, accomplished, as Jim said. The cross of our Savior, the Son of God, was horror, as we heard, humiliation. As Troy said, he was forsaken and betrayed. But it was his cross, and our sin placed him there. His amazing love for us held him there. It was all the perfect plan of God for us. If I can repeat the beautiful verse that Carol read, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." The very thing that Jesus came into the world to accomplish, our salvation, done. It is finished. Hebrews 9:26 says, in part, he, Jesus, has appeared once for all at the culmination of the age to do away with sin by the sacrifice of himself. Hebrews 10:14, for by one sacrifice he has made perfect forever those who are being made holy. Again, we see the sufficiency of the cross. We see what it means. It is finished. So now, once and for all, forever, the debt is canceled. He He did it. Further reflection on the sufficiency of the cross. As the precious blood of the Lamb flows down, as he dies on the cross of suffering, it is finished. But I would say, this is not defeat. This is not failure. This is victory. It is finished. He did it. This is victory. I think of things that I have faced. You can probably all think of things you have faced, and you couldn't wait to get to the other side of it. And when you did it, you said, oh, it's finished. That's victory. And this is what Jesus did, this great triumph for us, right with God forever, for all who believe in him. Could there be any greater hero? In our culture, we do love our heroes, our favorite athletes, our Marvel superheroes, our superstars of film and music, industry and politics. And as Christians, we do love the imagery of the Son of God as the great lion, our mighty, victorious king. We just sang about him being our king. He's the great I Am, our triumphant champion. He is all those things. He's there at the creation when every star was hung in the sky and every strand of DNA was fashioned in astonishing intricacy. He is in wonder, standing there in glory beside the Father as Stephen was stoned. He's there in Revelation with eyes like blazing fire and his face shining like the sun, wondrous in might and power. But somehow, all of that eternal, glorious might and inconceivable power was contained in time and space, in the sinless, humble servant on the cross, in the one, God's own Son, whose precious blood flowed down, who suffered and died for us. Oh, the blood of Jesus. Someone has famously said the greatest victory of the Son of God was not as the lion of the tribe of Judah, but as the lamb who was slain. Yes, we love to celebrate Easter, the resurrection. And it goes hand in hand with Good Friday, the crucifixion. But I don't think we need to wait until Easter Sunday to celebrate victory and triumph. And I love what Carol brought to us about taking up our own cross. He died to self for us. And long before he went, our Jesus, long before he went to the cross, we hear him in Matthew 16 saying to his disciples, deny yourself, take up your cross, and follow me. And I believe he's calling us, his followers, to walk with him in selflessness, but also in victory. When we are selfless, what will that bring to us? Victory. So, at the end, as Jim so powerfully told us about the lungs of Jesus, maybe there was only enough breath left in his lungs to barely whisper, it is finished. But in truth, it was a triumphant, victorious roar through all of time and space, once and for all. It is finished.
Crimson love, price of life's demand, shameful sin placed on him, the hope of every man. Oh, the blood of Jesus washes me. Oh, the blood of Jesus shed for me. What a sacrifice that saved my life. Yes, the blood, it is my victory. Savior, Son, Holy One, slain so I can live. Oh, see the Lamb, the great I Am, who takes away my sin. Oh, the blood of Jesus washes me. Oh, the blood of Jesus shed for me. What a sacrifice that saved my life. Yes, the blood, it is my victory. Oh, the blood of the Lamb. Oh, the blood of the Lamb. Oh, the blood of the Lamb. The precious blood. That saved my life. Yes, the blood, it is my victory. Oh, what love, no greater love. Grace, how can it be? That in my sin, yes, even then, He shed His blood for me. Oh, the blood of Jesus washes me. Oh, the blood of Jesus shed for me. What a sacrifice that saved my life. Yes, the blood, it is my victory. What a sacrifice that saved my life. Yes, the blood, it is my victory. Yes, the blood, it is my victory.
We specifically tonight wanted to hear from others and wanted to hear personal reflections from the cross. And I just love the theme. I hope you heard throughout that it is finished, right? It is accomplished. And here's what we need to know. It was accomplished for us. It was accomplished for us. Jesus didn't die on the cross for himself. Jesus didn't come down, take on flesh, live on this world and in this earth, on this earth, so that he could just experience it because he wanted to feel like what it was like. He created it. He knew. He came down because he loved you and me. He came down on a rescue mission, and he was willing to take upon himself the wrath of God, the ugly, horrible wrath that needed to be given out for sin. And he was willing to stand, or to die, I should say, in our place for that. What a beautiful day. I've often said, you know, it wasn't a good day for Jesus, but it's a great day for us. It's a great day. And so my hope is today is that, see, it's got to get personal. Because you can celebrate religion, and you can celebrate days like Good Friday and then Easter Sunday, and you can come to church, and as I say, you can punch your card, and you can do that, but that doesn't get you someplace. See, it's got to become personal. You have to understand your sin. You have to recognize your need, and you have to accept and receive that grace and that gift that God has given to you. He died for you. And you have to do that through faith, by trusting in that alone for your salvation. That's why Jesus came. He came for that, with that invitation, that you might have life. And I love it because he gave us a symbol, and it was actually the night before that crucifixion, that horrible day, as he sat with his disciples in what we call the Last Supper, the last Passover celebration that he did with his disciples, because it was a Passover celebration that he was celebrating with them. And they came together, and they enjoyed a meal together, and they sat around and they talked as they often would. But Jesus did something a little bit different that night. He took bread and he broke it. He broke that bread and he ripped it in half. And he passed it to his disciples. And he said, "This is my body, which is for you." And then later on after supper, he took the cup and he passed it and he said, "Drink of it, because this is the cup of the new covenant. This is my blood poured out for you. Take and drink." And as I'm sure a good disciple would, they just listened and did what he said and had no clue what he was talking about. But he was foreshadowing what would happen. He was giving them a picture of what was about to happen for them, because as we've talked about on Sunday mornings so often, you know, the disciples thought, as everyone else did, that the Messiah would come and have a political reign, that he would kick out the Romans, that he would reign supreme. But like we talked about last Sunday at Palm Sunday, Jesus didn't come to kick out the Romans. He didn't come to conquer Rome. He came to conquer us. And he came and died for sin. And so his body indeed needed to be broken. And his blood did indeed need to be shed, because a sacrifice needed to be paid. Because sin required a punishment, as we've heard tonight. And he was willing to pay that for us. And so he was willing to go to the cross for his body to be broken and for his blood to be shed as a sacrifice for our sin. And so tonight we're going to invite you to experience in communion with Jesus the bread and the fruit of the vine. The bread and the cup. Again, a picture of what Jesus Christ did, but again, it's got to be personal, because he did it for you. He did it not so that a bunch of people would get together thousands of years later in a religious ceremony and then walk on with their lives as normal. He did it to purchase our life, that we might be changed. He says that when you receive his grace and his mercy, you become a new creation. Old things are gone. Behold, all things are new. He takes away your burden and your sin forever. forever. And you stand before God clean, righteous. He even calls you holy at that point. Although if you're like me, I know I'm not holy. And yet I am before God because the blood of Jesus is applied to my life. And so we get to partake in this. And so I'm going to invite you to the table. And how we're going to do that is we're going to have ushers pass out bread. It's ripped bread already for you. You just have to take one and hold it, I would ask. And then after that, they're going to come with the cup, the fruit of the vine, and they're going to take that and pass that. You can take that, pass it along. But tonight is that time is a personal proclamation. Paul says that when you celebrate that, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. It's a personal proclamation of your faith in Jesus. And so I'm going to ask something tonight, and that is if you don't believe, if you haven't trusted in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, if you haven't recognized your sin and your need for a substitute to die in your place, but God is working on you, I'm good with that. But I would ask that you wouldn't participate, because this isn't a religious time, right? This isn't about punching a card. It's about a time where we acknowledge Christ and we say, yes, Lord, this is for me. And as I take in, I again feel, and in a way, I get a symbol of what Jesus had done, body broken for me, blood poured out for me. And so what I would ask is that you would just sit back and that you would reflect. And my great prayer is that you would see in all of this the culmination of your life, of how God has brought you to this moment, that you would realize your need for your sin, and that tonight, even tonight, you would believe and trust in only Christ alone for your sin. If you've done that, we invite you to participate. If this is your first time here, you are welcome to be. Like I said, the ushers will be coming around after I pray, and they'll be passing that out. You can just take it, hold it. We will participate together in that. So I'm going to actually have a moment of silence, because I want you to just begin to think about all that's been said tonight of what Jesus endured for you, and then I'll pray, and when I close, the ushers will begin to distribute the elements. Let's pray. Father God, we come tonight in reflection of you. Father, what horrors Jesus endured for us. The horrors of the punishment of sin Christ endured for us, that we might have life, that we might be clean, that we might be washed by the blood of the Lamb. Father, it was a horrible day for Jesus. It's an amazing day for us, because it's not a day of defeat. It's not a day of everything being done. I mean, it's not that the dream was now not realized. Instead, in fact, it was exactly what you came to do. It was indeed that the debt had been paid, that it had been accomplished, that it is indeed finished. And that we may now stand before you clean and forgiven, debt-free, that we might live for you, that we might have a life where we bear our cross, where we die to ourselves and we live for you. Oh, God, I thank you for that. I love you so much. I praise you. I thank you for what you've done. May you be glorified. In Jesus' name, amen. As Paul said in 1 Corinthians, he said, "For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus in the night which was betrayed took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" His body was broken. Again, the night before, he gave a powerful symbol of what they wouldn't understand then, but they would practice even as we do. We join into their practice even now of remembering that His body was ripped for us. By his stripe, we are healed, that we might have life. Take, eat, and remember what your God has done for you. It says, in the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. The fruit of the vine, again, a symbol of the blood of Jesus Christ poured out, spilt as a holy sacrifice, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. That is what he has done for us. Blood shed that we might be white as snow. Take, drink, and remember what your God has done for you. Father, we reflect on you, on your great sacrifice, on a great victory won for us, that we would have life eternal, whole, clean, free, complete. It is finished. It is accomplished for us. The debt has been paid. And in Christ, we have every spiritual blessing. Lord, may you be glorified. May Jesus Christ be lifted up. We love you, Lord. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Why don't you guys stand with us again as we sing in victory to him.
Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar, the Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Leave behind your regrets and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar, the Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar, The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, what a Savior. Isn't he wonderful? Sing hallelujah, Christ is risen. Bow down before him, for he is Lord of all. Sing hallelujah, Christ is risen. Bear your cross as you wait for the crown. Tell the world of the treasure you found. There's a place where mercy reigns and never dies. There's a place where streams of grace flow deep and wide. Where all the love I've comes like a flood, comes flowing down. At the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in all of you, I'm in all of you. Where your love ran red and my sin washed white, I owe all to you, I owe all to you, Jesus. There's a place where sin and shame are powerless.
Father, we do all owe all to you, Father. I love that line, Lord, where your love ran red and our sin washed white. God, thank you for the blood of Jesus. Thank you for the sacrifice of Christ. Thank you that you willingly went to the cross because you love us. I don't know why always, but I'm so thankful that you do. I'm so thankful that you love us, that you were willing to come, and that you invite us to come not only once, but every day, every moment to that altar of grace and mercy, and to experience and to feel your love and your grace and your mercy, God. You are awesome. And I love you. And I thank you. And I praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. I want to thank you for coming out tonight. I pray that it just blessed your soul in the fact of being able to just reflect. And our prayer is that you would even go home tonight and tomorrow and just reflect on what the cross means and what he did for you, and that you have life in that. If you need to talk about that at all, I'm going to be up front afterwards. I'm just going to hang out up here. If you want to come talk, if you want to ask questions, if you want to know more about Jesus' sacrifice to you, come up and talk to me. All right? Otherwise, we invite you to come back Sunday morning, 10 o'clock. We're going to have a tremendous celebration of the victory and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. You are invited. I'll encourage you to come a little early that day if you want to find a seat together. So we usually have a good crowd, so you just come on. We would love to have you. I want to end with a verse just for you to be able to walk out with and to feel and to let it wash over you. Isaiah was a prophecy of the Messiah to come. And it says this in Isaiah chapter 53, verse 4. It says, "Surely our griefs he himself bore, and our sorrows he carried. Yet we ourselves esteemed him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was pierced through for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The chastening for our well-being fell upon him. And by his scourging, you are healed." I love you guys. I hope you have a great night. We'll see you Sunday morning. Take care.